activity, or even maybe had to do a math video of how to, you know, multiply fractions. You have gotten used to being here tonight, and we are thrilled that y'all are here with us today. But then the question is, okay, well, we got to this point, great job, now how are we going to pay for it? And that's why we're here tonight. And what I always like to tell parents is, if there's a will, there's a way. There's a lot of solutions in financial aid. You're going to learn a lot about them tonight. You're also going to be given a lot of information tonight. But the one thing that I want you to remember is, if you were supposed to have all the answers to questions, we wouldn't have jobs. So we are here to serve you, to answer your questions. We're going to be here all summer from 8 to 4:30 every day. You can call us, you can email us, you can text us, you can tweet us, you can carry a pigeon if you need to. But we are here to serve you. And the faculty, staff, administration, we all have the same goal, and that's to see your student get enrolled, register, and then eventually the goal in 4 years is, of course, to graduate. So we want them to walk out of here, you know, as proud Nichols alum with degrees, and then go on and get jobs and be millionaires and be highly successful. So we have the same goals as you. One of the things, I know that most of the people in this room, by show of hands, how many people have been admitted? Awesome. How many people have confirmed for orientation? Okay, great news. For those of you, great job on that. For those of you who are not confirmed for orientation, we did send out our initial batch of invitations via email. So if you haven't received that, you may want to go back and check your email, because that is that is the first method of communication. And the spots are kind of filling up quickly. But as an added benefit and prize for your attendance tonight, I'm going to go ahead and tell you that the printed invitations are being mailed tomorrow. And so if you want your student to get the first choice, or your students want to get the first choice in their choice of program, go back and check the email tonight. And then if you can't find it, you can email us in the morning, and we'll re-email you an invitation. So with that being said, we look forward to seeing you at the orientation programs. Again, congratulations. We're going to have a question and answer session at the end. So if you have any specific questions, we're going to have staff on hand to be able to answer that. But with that, we'll get started, and I'd like to introduce your host for tonight. We have our Director of Financial Aid, Casey Treesh, and our Associate Director of Financial Aid, Garrett Claymore, also the Enrollment Services Information Specialist, and I call them the Wonder Twins. So I'm going to turn it over.
Can everybody hear me okay? Oh! Real good.
All right. Individuals with an education beyond high school are more likely to have better careers and earn higher wages. On average, a person with a college education can earn up to $1 million more than a non-graduate over their lifetime. With that said, we believe you deserve a successful career that is personally fulfilling and financially rewarding.
One second.
We are committed to making your college education affordable. And with that said, tonight we're going to go about discussing the financial aid application process and the types of financial aid. So you may ask, well, what is financial aid? Simply put, financial aid is there to help you pay for college and can come in the form of loans, grants, scholarships, and student employment. Federal student aid over last year awarded about $150 billion in student assistance. Here at Nichols, about 75% of our student population receives some form of financial aid. And every student who meets certain eligibility criteria can get some form of assistance, regardless of income or age. Before beginning your financial aid application, you have to establish an FSA ID. Before we begin that, it's not really relevant to talk about financial aid unless you actually know the cost of attending college. Now, here in the financial aid world, we're required to develop and disseminate a cost of attendance. And what that is, that's the basic average amount of tuition, fees, room and board, transportation,
as well as books and supplies.
Those are estimates based on what other students are likely to incur. It's not the actual amount of tuition and fees you'll actually have to pay. It's the way the federal government allows us to determine the maximum amount of assistance you qualify to receive. Cost of attendance can be broken down into direct and indirect costs. Direct costs are those fixed ones, such as tuition and fees and room and board if you live on campus. You actually receive a bill for those items and have to pay the institution. Whereas indirect costs, you don't actually pay us for those, but it's stuff that you incur related to your education, such as books and supplies and transportation to and from school. We want to be as transparent as possible, and discussing tuition and fees is an important part. Here at Nichols, you can expect to pay about $4,000 per semester. That estimate is based on a full-time undergraduate student. Now, please note, it may be a little bit different depending on your program of study as well as your enrollment status, but this gives you an idea of what you'd be likely to incur. Next, books and supplies. You don't pay Nichols for books and supplies. It's up to you where you want to get your books from. Obviously, we want you to go to the bookstore. We have it easily accessible and a variety of different options. However, you can choose to get them online or rent them from different places. So it depends. Depending on your classes, it could range from $250 per semester all the way up to about $600. So that gives you a range or an idea. So you want to budget about $500 per semester for books and supplies. Living on campus. Should your child decide to live on campus, including a meal plan, you can expect to pay about $3,700 to $5,200 per semester. We do have housing representatives here to discuss the different options that you can select, so please feel free to get with them after the presentation to see what your options are. Next, before we begin the financial aid application, it's good to establish an FSA ID. Your federal student aid ID identifies you as a person who can legally sign documents with the Department of Education. You'll use your FSA ID to sign your financial aid application, make corrections if necessary, as well as sign important documents if you borrow student loans. Both the student and the parent on the FAFSA will need their own FSA ID. You can apply for one if you have not done so already at studentaid.gov. How many of you guys in the audience have already completed the FAFSA? Well, you're gonna get a good refresher course in case you made any mistakes. But the FAFSA, or the free application for federal student aid, is your application process for the largest source of federal assistance that's out there. Note that we'll constantly emphasize the word free. You should never be assessed a charge or a fee to complete the FAFSA. It's done at a .gov website. Don't go to a .com or a .net. You must complete the FAFSA each year you plan to enroll, and it's one piece of the financial aid puzzle. Just so you know, if we would look at the 17-18 financial aid award year, that consists of the fall 2017, spring 18, as well as summer 18. If your child was planning to enroll this coming summer 2017, they would need to complete the 16-17 FAFSA. Now, there's two major changes in the financial aid landscape this year. One, you're now actually able to complete the FAFSA 3 months before in prior years. So in the past, you would have to wait until January 1st to complete the FAFSA. You can now start as early as October 1st. Also, the second major change is that you're able to use your prior year income information. So whereas in the fall 16, spring 17, you used your 15 income, which was previous year, for the 17-18 award year, you're also going to use your 2015 info. Now, the benefit of this is that your taxes have already been filed. They were due back in April of last year, so there's no reason now for you not to be able to complete the FAFSA. In the past, you used to have to rush to complete your taxes so you could file the FAFSA, or have to go back in and re-estimate or correct your estimates on that. So that's two major changes. What that will allow you to do is to ensure that while it may be a good academic fit for your student here, we want to make sure it's a good financial fit. So it'll give you more time to discuss your different options on making it affordable. When you're completing the FAFSA, you'll be asked for certain demographic and biographic information. It's really basic. Where you live, your social security number, citizenship, and residency status. You'll get to a point where you'll be asked, what schools do you want to provide on the FAFSA? Be sure you list Nichols, because that is the only way we're allowed to access your information. If at any time you need to go back in and make corrections to add a school, you can do so. Federal student aid programs are based on the concept that it is primarily you and your family's responsibility to pay for your education. And because it's assumed that a dependent student has the support of their parents, the parental information must be provided along with the student information to get an accurate picture of the family's financial strength. There is a series of questions to determine what your dependency status is on the FAFSA. If you're considered a dependent student, you must provide your parental information, whereas independent, you can go by your own and your spouse's. Most of you here tonight are considered a dependent student for federal student aid purposes. Now, you might ask yourself, well, I pay my own bills, I live on my own, I'm an independent student. Well, no, you have to ask these questions to yourself. So, if you can answer yes to any one of these questions, you may be independent. Are you 24? Are you married? Did you receive your bachelor's degree and are pursuing a graduate degree? Are you a veteran or actively serving in the armed forces? Do you have children that you support more than 50% on your own? Or if you have certain other circumstances, you may be considered an independent student. Otherwise, you must provide your parental information. So, federal government also defines who is considered my parent for the FAFSA. Step-parents, well, grandparents, aunts, uncles, brothers, sisters are not considered your parents. We'll go through a step-by-step process to actually determine who you should be reporting. Now, this chart will describe your biological or adoptive parents. We'll get to the role of step-parents later on in it, but when you're asking these first series of questions, we're talking about bio-mom and bio-dad. First step, are your parents married? If they are, you must provide information about both of them. If they're not married, but they're living together, regardless of if they're separated, divorced, or never married, you must provide both of their information. If you don't match either one of those categories, ask yourself, who did you live with within the last 12 months as of the date you completed the FAFSA? Depending on that result, that's the parent that you must provide on the FAFSA. Now, here's where step-parents come in. Ask yourself, does this person, have they been remarried since? If the answer is no, you provide that single parent's information only. But if that parent has since remarried, you must also provide your step-parent's information. On the other hand, if you did not live with a parent who provided the support, you must provide the one who provided the most support within the last time they provided you support, if that makes any sense. It's beyond 12 months. Depending on the result of that question, ask yourself, has that parent since remarried? If the answer is no, report that parent only. But if the answer is yes, you must provide the step-parent's information. When you get to the financial information section, you'll need to provide tax information related to your income and other financial data, such as your assets, as well as untaxed income, such as child support received. When you're going through these questions, it can be confusing and it can be difficult. There is a little icon on the side of the FAFSA, help and hints. You can click that and it'll give you a line-by-line definition of exactly what you should be providing or what you shouldn't be including. For example, for assets, you're asked, how many assets do you have? You might be wondering, well, the house that I live in is an investment and it's one of my assets. No, they specifically exclude it on the FAFSA, so you should not be including that. So those definitions will guide you and help you throughout the process on exactly what you need to be providing. This is really confusing. This is the most complex part of filling out the FAFSA, is determining all of the financial information. However, in a recent relationship between the FAFSA and the IRS, there is a new tool called the IRS Data Retrieval Tool, or the IRS DRT. What this will allow you to do is take the information directly from your tax return and plug it into the FAFSA. Reduces errors, eliminates the need of you going back and forth to figure out what line items need to go where, and it'll reduce the amount of paperwork that you need to submit to our office in the event that you're selected for verification. One thing that we ourselves have problems with is when you're required to, when you're linking up to the FAFSA, you need to provide your filing status and your address. The address is finicky. So look at your tax return, provide the address you did. Sometimes if you live at RD period, they might want you to put road. So it's kind of like a try and error thing. If it doesn't work out for you, it'll kick you out three times. Wait a little while, try again. It's worth retrying. Sorry, that is one flaw of it. There's a couple of other circumstances where you're not allowed to use the DRT, such as if you filed a foreign tax return or if you amended your tax return. But keep in mind, we're looking at 2015 income. You already filed those taxes. So there's no reason why you really can't use the DRT unless you're one of those exceptions. Once you've provided all of your information, you must sign the FAFSA. Sign it with your FSA ID. There's alternatives available, but it can delay the processing. You would not believe the amount of people that do the entire FAFSA and forget to submit it. And while it's saved, if you never actually complete it and submit it, the federal government will not begin processing your application. Let's talk about some frequent errors. Using nicknames is not a good idea. It doesn't matter if you go by Beyonce or Madonna. You must be providing the name that's on your Social Security card. Reason being, federal government goes through a series of matches. They'll look at your name, Social Security number, and date of birth to determine is it a legitimate identity. Another thing is the number and household. Federal government has specific guidelines on who is considered a part of your household. For example, if I have a 30-year-old sister living at my house, she has her own kid, but she has a job and supports them, they're not included on the FAFSA, even though they live in my household. So the government tells you who to put and who not to put on the FAFSA. Another thing, like we talked about earlier, assets, misreporting amounts, or putting stuff that you shouldn't be, is a common or frequent occurrence. All of the information that you plug into the FAFSA will yield your expected family contribution, or your EFC. That's the whole premise that the financial aid eligibility is determined, And what that is, that's the amount of money that the government says you, as a family, are expected to contribute to your child's education within the year. In reality, it's not the amount of money that you can afford to pay, nor is it the amount of money that your child will receive in financial aid. It's just the federal government's way of determining the types and amounts of aid you qualify to receive. Some of the factors included in that is your income, assets, and the number of family members in the household. Once you have completed the FAFSA, you'll receive a confirmation. It'll be emailed to you if you provided the email address on the FAFSA. You'll be sent your student aid report, or your SOAR. That's the processed results of your FAFSA, and it's the summary of the information you provided. Federal government will tell you of any alarms or issues that they have. If you really put Beyonce on there, they'll tell you, we're having some issues with your name. We can resolve it, but it's a good idea to review the SOAR and make any corrections if you have any errors. Once the results are sent to the schools that you selected, we'll receive it and request any information from you. For example, all first-time freshmen will have at least one item being requested of them. So we load the information into our student data system called Banner. Our primary method of communication is through your email account. We'll contact you through your personal email account as well as your Nichols student email account once it's been established. For example, you'll be provided with instructions on how to log into our system. Once you're logged into our system, you'll be able to access your outstanding requirements. So select the appropriate award year for what you're looking at, and we'll go ahead and tell you what's unsatisfied on your account. Review your unsatisfied information. The items that we need will be listed on there with instructions on exactly what you need to do to resolve that requirement. If it's a form that you need to complete, we'll give you a link to the form where you can print it out and submit it to our office. Also, if you submitted something to our office and you're waiting for it to be reviewed and you don't know if it has been, you can review your satisfied requirements and it'll say, hey, we looked at it. Or if they have any issues and a counselor is trying to contact you, they'll have some messages on there saying exactly what we need to resolve it. So be sure you get the email from us. If there's any outstanding requirements that are needed of you, please submit it in a timely manner. It's not an instant process. It does take time. So once we receive it, we will review it. If there's any other information needed from you, we'll contact you. But hopefully that's it. Now, the government selects about 30% of all applicants for verification. Verification is a process in which the government requires institutions to verify that the information you provided on the FAFSA is consistent with your income and household information. You may be asked to provide your tax return as well as means of support. Even for me, this is a lot of information to be telling you. You're gonna be confused, you're probably feeling overwhelmed, but if you get the gist of it, you'll be able to go along with the process with us as long as you follow the instructions. So it's a lot. All of the acronyms that we're using are on the bookmark that we provided for you, as well as the information sheet, so you can refer back to that when I start saying EFC, CPS, and all of this other BS. So, if we have everything we need and you're admitted to university, we can create a financial aid award package for you. You'll be processed for the maximum amount of assistance you qualify for to receive, including grants and loans. You'll receive an email and you'll be directed to our online system to review your award information. Once you log in, you'll be able to review your requirements, and you'll need to accept the terms and conditions of being a financial aid recipient. Basically, that means you'll have to look at our policies and procedures. It'll give you important information on what you need to do in the event that you have to drop a class or resign from the university. Once you accept those terms and conditions, you'll be allowed to review and accept or decline your financial aid awards. Grants and loans are automatically accepted on your behalf because it's free money. We'll place the loans in an offered status. Should you need those funds to pay for your education, you can choose to accept the full amount or a partial amount. Should you choose to accept the student loan, when you submit your award decision, there may be additional requirements created. So, for example, if you accept a student loan and you're a first-time borrower, immediately there'll be two items being requested: entrance counseling and a master promissory note. Casey will discuss that later on in the presentation of what those actually are, but just keep in mind, once you submit it, you'll have more unsatisfied requirements to do. It kind of just depends on what your award decision is. Now I'll turn it over to Casey to continue on the rest of our presentation.
Okay, so we're going to start with the types of financial aid. We have gift aid and we have self-help aid. Gift aid does not need to be repaid. Grants and scholarships fall under that category. Grants are based on financial need. Scholarships are based on merit or skill. Your self-help aid can consist of loans, which may be borrowed to help pay for expenses and are repaid with interest. We also have student employment on campus where students can work and actually earn money. There are four major sources or main sources of aid. The federal source is our major source of aid, and this is where the Pell Grants would fall in, this category, and also the Stafford loans, which is what we'll be talking about in a little bit. We also have state aid, which would be your top scholarship and your Louisiana Go Grant. Institutional aid would be aid that Nichols funds to students, comes in the form of scholarships usually. We also have private sources, which could be churches or businesses or maybe some employers give scholarships to people that work for them. The largest source of grants to students with need is the federal Pell Grant. This is limited to undergraduates seeking their first bachelor's degree. So we have students who maybe choose to come back for a second degree later on, which is fine, but they have to know that after you've obtained your first bachelor's degree, it stops there. You can no longer receive Pell Grant. Pell Grant is based on your EFC, which Garrett spoke about. That's your expected family contribution, and also your enrollment status. Enrollment status meaning the number of hours that you enroll in. If you are a full-time student or you take 12 hours, then you will be assessed 12-hour fees and receive a full-time or a 12-hour Pell Grant. There's kind of a myth on campus, if later on, once you've progressed in your program, you decide maybe you don't want to come full-time and you want to come half-time, students tend to think, well, I can't get a Pell Grant because I'm not full-time. That is not the case. If you decide to enroll half-time, you will then be assessed half-time fees and will receive a half-time Pell Grant. But even with the maximum Pell Grant award, it's still not going to fully cover your basic tuition and fees at most schools, which leads us into our next slide, which would be the Stafford loans. For the 17-18 year, the Pell Award, a maximum Pell Grant, if you qualify for it, would be about $2,900 per semester. So that's not going to be enough to cover basic tuition and fees. Gary gave an estimate of maybe $4,000, maybe a little less. But that was just an estimate. But you could see that the $2,900 alone is not going to cover that. So that brings us to Stafford loans. A lot of students choose to go this route and borrow through the federal loan program. It's a long-term loan. You do not need to do anything different to apply for it than you would have done for a federal Pell Grant. You start with the FAFSA, and from there we ask you for certain documents. You are going to be processed, we call it processed package, for the maximum loan for which you qualify to receive. So you don't have to ask for it. We will automatically package you for that maximum amount. You can then decide if you would want to accept all of it, or a part of it, or you want to decline it totally. Please be aware, though, if, let's say you accept it now and then decide right before school starts that you really don't need it, it's fine. You call us. We get you to write a statement. You can have it canceled. Or vice versa, if you decide up front you declined it because you didn't think you needed it, and then your financial situation changes, call our office. We can go back and put it in offered status and offer it to you again. So that is an option. And there are various repayment options available for the Stafford loan. There are two major types. You're going to hear us referred to a lot, the subsidized loan and the unsubsidized loan. The subsidized loan, you must have financial need, and the government pays the interest for this one while you are in school. The unsubsidized is not based on financial need, and the student is responsible for the interest. The student can choose to pay the interest while they are in school, or they can choose to capitalize it, and when they repay the loans after they graduate, they can just pay it all then. Your loan offer may come in a combination of sub and unsub. You may get some sub and some unsub. If you don't need to accept the full amount, we always encourage students to accept the subsidized loan first. It's more beneficial because the government's paying the interest for you. So if you need to decline one, you would want to decline the unsub if you don't need it all. Okay, the government sets annual loan limits for freshmen, well, for all students, just annual loan limits in general. Most of you in here will be considered dependent. As you can see, the max that you would be able to borrow for a year is $5,500. So that's $2,750 per semester. So $2,750 in the fall, $2,750 in the spring. This is not something that Nichols sets, by no means. It's the federal government, so depending on, it doesn't really matter what school you go to, $5,500 would be the max that you can borrow. As you increase in your classification, meaning as you become a sophomore, as you become a junior and earn more hours in your degree program, that amount will increase by about $1,000 a year, and that is on the handout. There's a chart with the loan figures. Besides annual loan limits, the government also sets cumulative loan limits. That means over the life of your college career, the maximum amount that a dependent undergraduate student can borrow is $31,000, with no more than $23,000 being in the form of subsidized loan. Because it's $31,000, when we counsel students in our office, we always tell them, make sure you are borrowing only what you need to pay for your educational expenses. We hate to see a semester or two before graduating, they may be borrowed in excess of what they needed repeatedly throughout school to pay for a car, to buy an iPhone, to purchase an iPad or whatnot. And that $31,000 limit comes a lot quicker than it should have. And they run out and they're not able to graduate with a semester or two left. So you only want to borrow what you need. Plus, remember, you're paying all of this back with interest. So, and then if along the way, a couple of years into your degree program, you get married, you have a kid that you provide over 50% of the support for, or whatever the case is, your limit then jumps to the 57.5. Okay, so before you may receive a Stafford loan, there are a few things you need to do. Garrett briefly mentioned these. You're going to have to do a master promissory note, which you will hear us refer to as your MPN. You will also have to do Stafford Loan Entrance Counseling. Both of these things are done at studentloans.gov, and you will use the student's FSA ID that you originally created. The master promissory note is basically a legal document. It's just your promise to repay your student loan plus interest to the federal government. And then your entrance counseling is basically a session on your rights and responsibilities as a borrower and what your repayment options are. So this is important. You can actually do this now without knowing if you're even going to need a loan. You can go to studentloans.gov. Once you have an FSA ID, you can complete it now. What happens is that you complete it. The government holds on to those two documents. We offer you a loan at the point you accept it. We then send that to the government. The government links the acceptance of the loan and the MPN and the entrance counseling and says, well, we have everything we need for this loan. sends it back to the school, and we're able to disperse the funds to the student's account. So it doesn't hurt to do it now, and the earlier you do it, the better. Because a lot of times that's the last two things, just keeping the loan, keeping us from being able to apply it to the student's account. So just get it out the way. Okay, so sometimes even after the Pell Grant, even after the Stafford loan, you may still fall short in paying expenses, especially if you live on campus. So there is another kind of loan called a Parent Plus loan. It's actually a loan for the parent to help pay for expenses. That's based on credit. It's a credit check, though, for this one. To apply, the parent goes to studentloans.gov. Again, you're going to be using that website a lot throughout the college career. But in this one, you need to pay attention because the parent should be using their FSA ID. We get problems sometimes where we can't find the application and the student keeps checking, and we end up discovering that the wrong FSA ID was used. This is the parent's loan for the student, so it's the FSA ID of that of the parent. If it is approved, the parent can either specify amount they want to borrow, or we will package you for the maximum amount that the student can receive up to their cost of attendance, which Garrett talked about. If the credit is declined, this allows the student to get an additional $4,000 in unsubsidized funds. A lot of parents cross their fingers, hoping the Parent Plus loan gets denied, right? Because nobody wants another loan in their name. But if it is declined, it does allow the student to get the additional money. The federal government doesn't allow us to go beyond that $5,500 that we just talked about unless we would get a denial, and then we can give the student the additional unsub money. And all of these Stafford loans, the Parent Plus loan, it really is lower interest rates than you would normally get with a loan. There's also another route you could take. We have alternative or private loans. Alternative and private loans are non-federal loans. All the things we've been talking about were federal aid. It's a non-federal loan. You would just go to the lender of your choice, see if they participate in the alternative loan or the private loan. Sometimes they refer to them as signature loans. You would go through it with them. It's based on a credit check. They all have their own little rules and stuff. Sometimes you need a co-signer to be able to do it. Nichols will certify it for you, and we disperse the money. It's just a little different from the Stafford loan. The major thing with an alternative loan is that we do have information about it on our website, and it gives a lot more information than right here, so you're welcome to check that out. But the main thing, the downfall, is that it's a lengthy process. So you can't come a week before school starts thinking, oh, I have this balance that I don't know how I'm going to pay it. I'm going to go and do an alternative loan. While that might be an option and that might be a good route to go, it's very lengthy. So whereas Stafford loans, the turnaround time can be really quick sometimes, this one's lengthy. You're looking at 3 to 4 weeks of just going back and forth with your lender. Nichols just basically certifies it, and then we disperse the money. But it's really a process between you and the lender, and it is lengthy. So just be aware of that. You would want to start that early if that is the route that you choose to go. It's a more expensive route to go, though, than our Stafford loans. But sometimes when you don't have a choice, people do go this route. Another option is student employment. If your student is interested on campus employment, they should indicate yes on the FAFSA that they are interested in federal work study. They can also fill out a student employment application. They can pick one up in our office, in the financial aid office, or there is a form online as well. It's basically just like a regular job. They earn minimum wage, they're paid on an hourly basis, the funds are given to them through direct deposit or however they set it up. So that is an option. Okay, so let's take a look at the process, an overall, just a repeat of everything. You do the FAFSA. The school is going to receive your student aid report. At that time, we will send you an email telling you that you need to check your Banner account, that you may have outstanding requirements. At the point you complete those requirements or finish filling out all documents and those are satisfied, we can then create you an award package. When we create you an award package, you would then go in and either accept or decline the award you want. Like Garrett said, grants and scholarships are automatically accepted on your behalf. Loans, we don't do that. Loans, you have to pay back with interest. So, of course, we let you make that decision. So you actually have to go in and accept the loans. The earliest funds may be applied to a student account is 10 days prior to the start of a semester. This is not a Nichols rule, this is a federal government rule. So 10 days before the start of any semester is the first time we can release the money. Okay, so now that we've talked about what you need to do to receive the financial aid, the next major thing is how to keep the financial aid. You will hear us, and then students will become very familiar with us talking about SAP, which is Satisfactory Academic Progress. The federal government makes all universities come up with a SAP policy. We check SAP at the end of each semester. Students need to have a minimum GPA of a 2.0, and that's a cumulative GPA. So as long as you keep making at least a 2.0 each semester, your cumulative one will stay at a 2.0 and you will be okay. The other part of it is that you need to complete 67% of the hours you attempt. So you need to continuously do this to stay in the cumulative range. Just to give you an example, if your student enrolls in 15 hours, and maybe they need to drop a course because of whatever reason, work conflict or whatever, as long as they pass the remaining 12 hours with at least a 2.0 GPA, so you started with 15, you needed to drop down to 12, as long as you pass the 12 with at least a 2.0 GPA, you will be good, and you will be maintaining what we call SAP. Another major thing is that you have to attend class. We cannot stress that enough. Pell grants are attendance-driven. If you are not in class, the federal government requires us to take away the Pell funds for that course, return them to the government, thus leaving you a balance owed to Nichols. You want to go to the class. Another major thing is before a student drops or resigns from the university, drops meaning drops a class, or resign meaning dropping all courses, maybe some medical emergency or whatever, we always, always, always encourage, suggest, whatever, that they come and talk to somebody in financial aid first to find out all the implications that can occur from doing so. We don't want you to come back to school next semester or a year from now and have all these things following you that you maybe didn't check on first, that we could have maybe ironed out before you dropped or before you resigned.
All right, just to reiterate what Casey said, no matter what school you choose to attend, all institutions who participate in federal student aid are generally bound by the exact same rules: verification, processing awards, disbursement, as well as a SAP policy. So no matter where you go, each school will have their individual policy, but it's going to be more similar than different. For example, at some schools, they don't actually apply your money to your account until a month into school. Here at Nichols, we do it as early as we federally can. So other schools might wait and delay the processing. We want to make sure that you have your money to be able to succeed in your classes. Another thing I cannot stress enough, borrow wisely. When I was a senior in college and my first year of graduate school, I decided to take out a student loan. I did not need the money, but I was able to party like a rock star. Three kids and one mortgage later, I am almost finished paying off my student loans, and it feels really, really good. So keep that in mind when you're going to accept a student loan. Borrow wisely. Now, before we get into the TOPS scholarship award processes, I want you to know that this is based on what we currently know about the regulations and eligibility criteria for the TOPS award. We are hopeful that the results of the upcoming legislative sessions are in favor of higher education and for you and your family. However, we want to make sure that you're prepared in the event that the program is drastically changed or not fully funded. So like Casey said, if you need to complete the entrance counseling and master promissory note now, that does not mean you don't have to accept the loan. You can decline it, cancel it at any time. It's affirmative confirmation. You need to tell us you want the loan, and you'll always have the right to cancel it if you really don't need it. So to apply for TOPS,
All you have to do is list the Louisiana institution on your FAFSA. That information is sent to the Louisiana Office of Student Financial Assistance. They're your administering authority for the top scholarship program. That information is joined up with the information that your high schools send, as well as your ACT scores, to determine what types of awards that you qualify for. Here at Nichols, we have three different levels of the top scholarship program: opportunity, performance, and honors. Each of them have their own GPA and ACT requirement. They all require you to have a completion of the core curriculum, and the GPAs and ACTs are listed right here. One thing, Nichols does not participate in TOPS Tech. We cannot process awards if you're eligible for that award. In order to retain your TOPS, you must earn 24 hours each academic year with the appropriate GPA for your type of award. As I said earlier, TOPS is the administering authority for it, so they'll determine what you're eligible to receive. They'll notify you, and they'll give you your rights and responsibilities, as well as what you need to do to continue receiving your TOPS. Here at Nichols, our Assistant Director of Financial Aid, Brandy St. Pierre, and Scholarships, she's the TOPS guru. So if you have any questions about TOPS or have any issues, stop by Candy's Hall, she's in there, or give her a call, shoot her an email. She can tell you everything you need to know if you're trying to debate whether you need to come to summer school to maintain your TOPS or what you actually can and cannot do. Other scholarship opportunities. The university publishes additional scholarship opportunities on our financial aid webpage. It's also disseminated in the weekly newsletter Inside Nichols that is sent to your student's email account. It'll list the details of the scholarship award with the eligibility criteria, as well as the application process. Many of the applications allow you to complete it online. While some require a paper application, you'll just stop by the office and pick one up for us. It's a good opportunity to get a little extra money to pay for books and stuff. Any financial aid that you receive cannot exceed your cost of attending school. So keep that in mind. Sometimes if you're receiving a lot of money, we may have to reduce some of your awards to prevent an issue later on down the line. So it doesn't happen often, but it's just something that you may want to be aware of. Now, outside of financial aid, you may be receiving assistance and it might not cover all your fees, or you're waiting on that big juicy tax refund to come in, and you know it's gonna be in, so you wanna set up a payment plan to split it up. Our payment plans here at Nichols require 50% down and 50% later. Throughout the semester, you'll be given the option to split it up into two additional payments, so it kinda gives you a little bit more flexibility. In that first payment, you can count all your financial assistance in there, but one thing you wanna make sure is it's within the semester, so you only have like 2 to 3 months to come up with those additional funds. So you want to have a strategy in place to make sure you have that money. All right.
We basically want you to know that our doors are open. We are here to serve you and help you. We usually exhaust all avenues in trying to help students, and sometimes if we can't help you, we're going to be on the phone trying to, you know, get with others on campus, so we can try to figure it out. Our office hours are from 8 to 4:30, Monday through Friday. We're located in the front of the campus in Otto Candy's Hall. So basically, don't be afraid. And I think once, especially as freshmen, students come and they want to grab onto somebody, right? We want to be those people. If you need help in any area, even beyond financial aid, we're there to help you. We're going to have a question and answer session now. Somebody will be walking around with a microphone if you have any general questions. If you don't feel comfortable doing that and you would rather ask a question in private, when we go down into the lobby, there will be people there to answer your questions as well. But we really want to thank you all for coming out, and we hope that you at least, even if you learned the process even a little bit or became familiar with the terms that we use, then we feel like we've done our job. So now, thank y'all.
Now keep in mind, many of the questions that you have right now, the people sitting next to you may also have it. So if you're comfortable saying it out in public, you may be able to help somebody else. So we'll have our two counselors walk around with the microphone. Please raise your hand, ask us a question. It's a lot of information. So do we have any questions?
It's important to have the name exactly right, but looking at the FAFSA, my son is a fourth. There's no place to put a suffix.
So oh my God, that's a horrible situation to be in. Just really, really bad. Gwen, can you elaborate on that? We try our best to keep matching it, but sometimes they want you to put I, like four times. But if you're having an issue getting it to match with Social Security Administration, we can look into it for you, because that is a common occurrence. Or people with a really, really long last name, it's something that happens too.
Should I put his last name and then the suffix right after that?
Yes, all okay. In one.
All right.
Come on, people. I know y'all have questions. We have one right here.
Okay, when we filled out the FAFSA and my daughter put in her ID, it automatically went. I didn't get to put in my ID. Will it come back so I could put in my signature ID?
At the end, when you fill out the FAFSA and she entered and she said agreed and signed it, it should have had another section underneath with yours that said accept. And
but she still got the email that said that it's confirmed.
It was processed.
And I never put in mine.
You didn't put in the FS. Had you did the IRS data retrieval?
Yes, I did.
That's why. It was already there.
Okay. The other question is, where do I find the student aid report, the SOAR?
That should be emailed to you.
And if it's not emailed, you can always log back into the FAFSA, and you can get a PDF printout of your student aid report. But anytime, if you have any questions, like before, we can tell you if there's any issues with the FAFSA or any documents that you need to turn in. Oh, we have one over here. You could talk it. I'll repeat it.
No. IV. I have another child that comes here, and when I went to do hers, it threw me out because I couldn't remember my username or my ID or nothing, my password, nothing. How can I reset it? I've done hers. She's done, but it's to get
the best thing that we recommend. If you know you have an FSA ID and they kind of hide the tab, you can go to edit my ID. And if you forgot any of the information, if you either provide your email address or your ID, they'll email you one of the options to be able to go ahead and reset it. If you haven't set up your FSA ID, do not put your student's email account as your own or vice versa and try to set it up, because it'll link up and it's horrible to try to get it unlinked or deactivate an account. So. Where you from? I have no idea where that's at, but if you feel like coming to Thibodaux, we'll be happy to sit down with you and get it straight all in one shot. Come and see us. You can either schedule an appointment or just stop by anytime. We have all of our counselors here, and we know the process pretty good, so we'll be able to help you through it. Yes, ma'am. We have a question in the back over there. If you did not choose the federal work study question, you can always go to our financial aid webpage. Under the form section, you'll have the student employment app, or we can add it to your account. It's no big deal. Do not go into the FAFSA and make a correction just to answer that question. Because since the government is random, they could randomly select you for verification, and all because you needed to change that one question. So just pick up an app from us. We might actually have it here tonight.
When do they get their SARS report?
The SAR is usually, once they send you the confirmation, within 3 days, you should receive a copy of the student aid report. If you didn't, you can log back into the FAFSA, and you'll see it right there. They'll give you a PDF. You could actually save it and keep it in your records. Yes, ma'am.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's on. Okay. So we did FAFSA receive the SARS report, so all that's complete. So how long do we wait, or how long can we expect to wait until we receive the package?
The package.
Right.
Well, you see, it's a sticky and difficult situation. Like we explained earlier, we're required to derive that cost of attendance. And like all of the other institutions in the state, most of us share a lot of the transportation, books and supplies, and miscellaneous expenses components. That's because the state does a really good job at calculating those figures. So all of the institutions who are members of our professional association use those as well. Once they publish those figures and we can get a close to good idea of what tuition and fees will be, then we'll start awarding financial aid. We've never done it later than April, so it'll be coming soon, hopefully before April.
It's a crazy question. When is money due? The reason I'm asking is because I've came by and we are VA qualified, but I cannot do anything with VA till July.
Good question, and I will lie to you right now. Fees are due before the first day of classes. Regardless of what you hear, do not wait until the semester begins. Pay fees before classes begin. So if they begin on a Monday, you pay that Friday before, and you'll be good to go.
Okay, second question about that. Housing, it doesn't pay for housing. If she qualifies for a Pell Grant or anything else, does that pay for the housing part, or... Okay. It all comes out of my money.
Here in the financial aid world, unless a specific fund is dedicated to a certain component, we look at it like a pot. If you're on campus, if you have tuition and fees, that goes into the pot of amount, like the money that you owe. Any financial aid that you receive will first be applied to offset those charges. Now, once those charges are all paid, if there's money remaining, like a credit balance, we can give you a refund check to pay for your indirect cost for books and anything else. Now, a lot of people have to pay money because there's a difference between the two. So it depends on how much aid you're actually receiving. So you can receive enough to pay for it. It just depends on what types and how much aid you're receiving. Tell her to answer the question.
She's scared.
Don't be scared. We're all human. All of us have been through the college process, or we have children that are enrolled in college, so we know it's a confusing process. Back here.
On her banner page.
Yeah. Don't know what to tell you about that, but it's a really simple fix, and I'll look at it later on. It's just dawned on me. Don't keep completing it. We'll look into that and make sure that it's rectified as soon as possible, but that is minor. That won't stop you from being processed for your financial aid awards. When disbursement comes a week before school, then it could be a problem. But rest assured, if you did it, it will be satisfied.
Is this thing on? Okay, just kidding. How soon after you apply?
TOPS. You will not hear anything from TOPS until after your child has graduated and all of the information has been sent to them. So, okay, if you have the ACT and you meet that, if your GPA, you have all of the core courses with the core GPA, the state's going to determine when they'll notify you. In the past, it's been July. After graduation. So then you kind of find out what it is, and you might know that you're receiving it. Doesn't mean the state's funding it, though. So it's kind of like a waiting game. That's why we always recommend you come up with a backup or an alternative. If you need additional money and you have to go the student loan route, just have it waiting there, just in case, until you find out more about TOPS. Sure. Brandy Sue St. Pierre, where are you? Okay, the answer to that question is in guidance in your high school senior year, you'll set up an account with LOSFA. That account, that's how they'll notify you of exactly what you qualify to receive. Hey, Brandy, this is Brandy. She's our scholarships coordinator, so make sure you stop by and give her a big old hug. But you'll find out through your LOSFA student portal. Yes, ma'am.
Does the payment plan include tuition and housing when you said half? And
yes, ma'am. So to be a little bit more specific, any financial aid that you receive could go towards that 50% payment. So if you owe $10,000 in tuition and fees, and you're receiving $5,000 in financial assistance, theoretically, you met the requirement for that 50%. But you want to make sure you have that remaining $500 within the next 2 or 3 months. $5,000, what I said, $500? Whew, if only it was that cheap. Okay, guys, if y'all don't have any additional questions, please feel free to join us after. Come ask us anything that you have. Stop by, get some refreshments in the lobby, and we look forward to talking to you. Thank you for coming tonight.